My lover's got humor. She's the giggle at a funeral. Knows everybody's disapproval. I should've worshipped her sooner. If the heavens ever did speak, she's the last true mouthpiece. Every Sunday's getting more bleak. Fresh poison each week. We were born sick, you heard them say it. My church offers...
Let's be clear at the outset. The speaker of Take Me to Church is no God-fearing man. This much is clear from the song's opening lines, and yet labels like anti-religious or anti-Christian are, while not wrong, profoundly unsatisfying as ways of naming the speaker's ideological project as a whole. And with Hozier making some of the best use of the English language we've seen from a mainstream hit in decades, I figured that a thorough discussion of the song will at the very least prove, despite appearances, that I don't in fact live in a bubble that filters out any song written after the 70s. And I'll start by saying that out of the many things the song offers as a work of art, a successful critique of, or even a complicated perspective on, religion, or Christianity more specifically, is simply not one of them. Judging by many a comment section, it seems that a good number of lyric enthusiasts on every side of the Bible Belt are taking the seek and you shall find approach to the song's divisive subject matter, quickly taking it from a subjective work of art limited in its perspective, as is all representation, good and bad, to an excuse for every rightist, leftist, uptist, downist, and diagonalist to show off their encyclopedic knowledge of baby can read 21st century political discourse. Hey, did you hear that hot new Take Me to Church by Hozier? Ugh, he clearly hates God. I refuse to enjoy the song of a hellbound sinner. Oh yeah? Hozier respects homosexual rights. You backward homophobe, hellbound sinner, backward homophobe, hellbound sinner. Yo mama is a hellbound sinner and a backward homophobe. And on and on and on into nausea-inducing pull back that hammer infinity. The more commentary I hear on this song, the more I am convinced that what folks that use this and other similarly divisive songs to draw battle lines in the sand of the socio-political playground really need is a nice, hot, steamy, thorough, close reading. When taken holistically, the song doesn't exactly cohere as the biting critique of Christianity it initially appears to be. Sure, when considered in isolation, there are many places in the text that are liable to send solar flares erupting beneath more than a few papal collars. But if anti-theism happens to be the way your ideological winds are blowing, you're likely to find much deeper and more convincing means of losing your religion in the non-fiction section of your local Barnes & Noble. Oh, you don't get off that easily.
Hellbound sinner!
Seriously, where in the lyrics do we find one unequivocal, direct statement that champions homosexual rights? I mean, is there a really subtle G in the pre-chorus that I'm just not picking up on?
Gay. Gay men. Gay men. Gay men.
To be fair, I think a lot of people are letting the music video, with its infuriating images of what must be the Russian equivalent of the KKK, over-influence their reading of the lyrics. But since when is the music video and the song to be considered one and the same? It's like passionately arguing about the perils of faffing about on treadmills in the comments section of OK Go's Here It Goes Again's lyric video. Having come of age in the pre-YouTube era, in which MTV and VH1 had us lapping up musical content before it speedily evaporated beneath the harsh sun of reality television, I am no expert on music videos, but I'm pretty sure that the song and the video are allowed to have two different narratives. Unless we assume that the speaker is a woman, which is hard, though not impossible, to do over Hozier's soulful baritone, the language of the song is repeatedly and undeniably gendered in male-female terms. Thus, if it's aimed at anyone, it's probably at religious authorities that decry the evils of premarital sex. But since that's not exactly an earth-shattering social issue, as it's one of those sins with which even many Christians take a don't-ask-don't-tell approach, those with an affinity for seeing songs as a form of social activism can be forgiven for making the short leap to the much more prevalent topic of homosexual rights. And a lesbian reading of the text is made possible by assuming that the the speaker is a female, but I've not seen anyone interpret the text along these lines. Arriving at the conclusion that the words of the song pay tribute to man-on-man love, however, is most likely the result of not looking very closely at lyrics that are but a Google search away. With tons of literature out there that clearly does celebrate the gay cause, I'm a little puzzled as to why we are seeking a champion where only the most tortured reading, if any reading at all, will call him forth. The song is really good, though, at being pretty, both linguistically and musically, but it's unlikely to cause any serious fractures in anyone's ideological bedrock. And like Lennon's Imagine, it'll sing you sweetly to sleep, but you're probably going to wake up just as hellbound and/or homophobic as you were when you turned out your nightlight. Now hold on, Lennonites. Before you reach for your torches and pitchforks, this isn't to be taken as a shortcoming, and I'll attempt to explain exactly what the song simplifies and complicates as this analysis unfurls. While songs are certainly capable of a honed philosophical edge, a single of any reasonable length just can't accommodate the gallons of ink that need to be spilled in order to pursue the eternal questions with the kind of rigor they deserve. The precision and depth we might expect from a philosophical treatise simply isn't a fair expectation to map onto a song or any short work of art. And short though it may be, Church is the kind of text that requires us to lovingly attend to its every voluptuous curve if we are to walk away with any insights beyond the autoerotic gratification of our own political fixations.
You want it all, but you can't have.
So it seems that a close reading is just the aphrodisiac the doctors ordered, but one with a deliberately narrowed focus so as not to rub ourselves raw with the fetishistic attention to minor detail that that method demands. Our guiding questions, which when taken together, will help us develop a calmer, more measured understanding of Church's potentially volatile elements, are as follows. What exactly is the speaker's spiritual orientation? Whose version of religious truth is the speaker attempting to subvert? What ideology does he attempt to install in its place? And what are we to make of the speaker's treatment of religion as a theme, embedded as it is within a text that otherwise has more thematic kinship with
I wanna sex you up?
Bearing these questions in mind, let's revisit the song's intro, this time through to the pre-chorus.
My lover's got humor. She's the giggle at a funeral. Knows everybody's disapproval. I should've worshipped her sooner. If the heavens ever did speak, she's the last true mouthpiece. Every Sunday's getting more bleak. Fresh poison each week. We were born sick, you heard them say it. My church offers no absolute. She tells me worship in the bedroom. The only heaven I'll be sent to is when I'm alone with you. I was born sick, but I love it. Command me to be well. Hey, hey, amen. Hey, amen. Amen.
When we consider how many musical panegyrics lead with sentiments barely more thoughtful than I like your pants around your feet, that the speaker draws our attention to his lover's humor is a choice that should give us pause. In fact, the song, at least at this point, characterizes its goddess figure as more of an Athena or an Artemis than an Aphrodite, leaving the details of her full lips, ample bosom, and head of strong flowing herbal essences infused hair to our imaginations. He tells us not that she giggles at funerals, which would still reveal a lot about her, but that she is the giggle at a funeral. That irreverence, namely humorous irreverence, in the face of something so intrinsically humorous as a funeral, constitutes her very being. The kind of girl that knows everybody's disapproval is probably not somebody you want to take home to mama, but at least the speaker can still bank on the fact that he's not dating her much more brazen cousin, the comically timed fart at the funeral. The word worshipped offers us our first verbal bead over which to meditate, While it's not unusual to use worship in an erotic context, the speaker, as we will soon see, is doing much more with this word than capturing the rapture of the sexual act. He's placing the sacred and the profane in direct opposition, establishing a tension that he will sustain throughout the song, though most pointedly at the beginning. Moreover, like a lot of good literature, the speaker is muddling and will continue to muddle the distinction between two concepts that are conventionally held to be polar opposites, prompting us to consider all that is profane about the sacred and, what I believe to be his chief concern, all that is sacred about the profane. How, you might ask? Well, let's think about it. The word that is tied most closely to worship is funeral. We don't have to be church-going folks to know that many acts of worship, praying, singing, the exchange of comforting assurances of a life after this one, happen at a funeral. So with the speaker's statement that he should have worshipped her sooner all, it tends to give that, wait, what, effect. To call upon a term I use often because it's friggin' everywhere, the speaker juxtaposes the giggle, a powerful symbol of lightheartedness and innocence, with the funeral, an equally powerful symbol of death, gravity, and for many, finality. He then explicitly tells us not only that he has chosen to worship the giggle, for remember that she is a giggle, but that he should have done it sooner. This acceptance of the giggle goddess, a deity that, judging by the name, must surely preside over the Hello Kitty universe, is also a tacit rejection of the funeral and all the ceremony that comes with it. This is not a rejection of just any old church service, but of a funeral. The one place where even someone as violently opposed to spirituality as, say, the late Christopher Hitchens would reasonably be expected to contain his comically timed farts for a half hour or so. Whoever this lover is, she suffers a demotion from giggle goddess to prophetess in the next verse, from being divine to merely speaking for the divine. A couple of subtle clues leave us with the impression that the speaker is not so much atheist as agnostic. The if at least leaves open the possibility of heavenly voices playing a role in earthly affairs, and last implies that other true mouthpieces have come before. Since these are possibilities that no serious atheist would entertain, the claim that the song is just another arena in which to pit believers against non-believers doesn't quite capture it. Like John Milton's version of Satan, the speaker's not denying God's existence. He simply sees bleakness and poison where others see the sunlit path of righteousness. Next, we get a reference to what can only be the doctrine of original sin. The idea that because Adam and Eve just had to eat from the overpriced VIP section of Eden's vegetarian menu, humanity down through the ages has been born sick with sin. The speaker then explicitly addresses his listener in the form of a you, attributing the born sick dogma to a them that, given the surrounding context, can only be the clergy and their fellow adherents. It's a minor detail, but because the listener through whose fictitious ears we are experiencing the text is an earshot of the message being preached from the pulpit, it makes a lot of sense to imagine that we're in the pew next to the speaker, politely trying to endure that brand of bad breath so peculiar to the Sunday morning church service as he relays in pungent whispers his strangely anti-religious infatuation with the personified giggle across the aisle. It's difficult at first to know precisely how to take the speaker's point about his church offering no absolutes, since he could be talking about the church of bleakness and poison, or the church of the giggly mouthpiece. Common sense would assure us that it's the latter. After all, much of religion's appeal lies in its purveyance of moral absolutes in a world that would otherwise succumb to the agonizing uncertainties of moral relativism. The church that offers no absolutes wouldn't really be a church in the literal sense of the word. Thus, we can conclude that the no-holds-barred freedom that comes with a belief system purged of absolutes attracts the speaker to the giggle goddess's priesthood. Well, that and the fact that her priests likely get to parade around in crotchless cassocks, but that's neither here nor there. The idea of worshiping in the bedroom provides us with our first clue that the speaker's new religion is in fact steeped in eroticism. I mean, it could be that her bedroom, with its monk-like ambiance and matchless view on the holy city of Jerusalem, puts you in just the right mood for prayerful meditation, but we've cause to doubt that. Unless we assume that we are the object of the speaker's infatuation, in which case I'll think about it once you're on your fifth box of Tic Tacs, the speaker starts to direct his words to the goddess herself, and we can finally resume breathing through our noses. The speaker's ideological project, which we will call the privileging of the profane, takes on an especially subversive character when he revisits his born sick refrain. Now clearly preferring to bask in humanity's great fall. Shelving command me to be well and the litany of amens in the pre-chorus until we've got a fuller context in which to appreciate these lines, let's take some time to clarify exactly whose Christianity the speaker is opposing. One needs only a working knowledge of the Bible, the grounding for Christianity in all its guises, to see that the speaker's view on this interpretively tricky, undeniably foundational, and surprisingly diverse collection of ancient texts is blinkered to say the least. Strip away all the euphemistic flora and fauna of Song of Solomon, for example, and you end up with a veritable buffet of sexual imagery. Furthermore, having children and all the sex that necessarily precedes it was seen as the means of immortality when the Hebrews still had only the vaguest conceptions of heaven and hell. Not to mention the endless chain of so-and-so begets so-and-sos that readers like to skip over to get to all the murder, genocide, beheadings, crucifixions, and even a bit of incest. Content that, were it to be represented with all the rawness that 21st century audiences have come to expect, would have quite the run on HBO. If the Bible is nothing more than a 1,200-page recipe for sexual frustration, where did all those begotten babies come from? Are we to believe that they simply sprung out of hooves in the ground? Or that their parents were able to maintain a state of arousal by stoically fixating on their duty to ensure God's chosen population a steady growth rate? Make no mistake, the Bible contains many thou shalt and thou shalt not prescriptions, limiting how and with whom we are to worship in the bedroom. But to many scholars and believers alike, an act of worship it remains. And even if, oh erotic chimera, you fancy yourself the bodily incarnation of Earth's every sensual delight, chances are you're not running in a bestiality marathon this weekend, or vigorously lobbying for the natural rights of pedophiles. Every society from ancient to modern has had its share of sexual norms and taboos, but none except perhaps a society of millennia-old vampires would dream of making sex itself a taboo. We can argue all day over what the Bible does and does not condone and condemn, and all century over whether Old and or New Testament perspectives on human sexuality are palatable to our highly advanced, scientifically grounded 21st century moral sensibilities. But if your desire is for me to demonstrate how much more enlightened we are than the still-developing desert-dwelling societies of antiquity, arriving at the same boring self-congratulatory insight into their religious and moral precepts as every other well-fed, clothed, and thoroughly vaccinated pseudo-anthropologist with air conditioning and internet connection, then oh, come on, don't hit the dislike button, Your Imperial Highness. Instead of deluding ourselves into believing that we would have been marching toward equal rights while the rest of Israel marched away from the latest famine, let's be reminded here that artistic representations, of which songs are one form, have no inherent obligation to account for the full complexities of the text to which they respond. But with the dichotomy-driven action of Take Me to Church, we nevertheless need to establish exactly what the speaker is reacting against. For a reader simply trying to reach a deeper understanding of a text, we're not so much concerned with planting a given work firmly within the details of its predecessor, as anchoring emerging interpretations within established traditions, which are themselves interpretations. The speaker's religification of eroticism, if I may avail myself of that adorable academic affinity for made-up words, stands in starkest contrast, not to some nebulous Christianity, a faith whose countless denominations are religions unto themselves, but to patriarchy, of this is a man's world social system that both feeds and is fed by specific interpretations of the Bible. Patriarchy, though, is a primed, loaded, and much disputed word in feminist discourse, and I have neither time nor inclination within a close textual analysis of a song to properly and fairly examine the extent to which it still permeates our social, economic, and political institutions. As mired as the term is by present-day academic gobbledygook and fall off the leftmost side of the earth political agendas, it does, nevertheless, help describe why historically, men of many faiths have found brothel hopping to be a perfectly gentlemanly Sunday afternoon pursuit, while their sisters and mothers were being drowned and burned as witches because their ankle-length skirts were borne aloft by a particularly randy gust of wind. I speak hyperbolically, of course, but since it's generally held that it's women who have had to bear the weight of the chastity belt, we might find it a little odd that the speaker, on the fair assumption that he is male, is the one that seems to feel so oppressed by patriarchy's poison. If caught sneaking away for a quick tete-a-tete in the confessional booth, it's the giggle goddess we would expect to be fitted with a pair of concrete slippers. The most the speaker would have to do in recompense is make legitimate and intermittent use of the booth between bouts of gentlemanly brothel hopping. Since there's nothing in the text that precludes reading it as a monologue from a woman to a woman, as the speaker never says, "Hey, I'm a dude," or anything of the like, we can see why a lesbian reading of the song might be even more compelling than a straight-up close reading. But since it would require another video to properly explore, we'll stick to the default speaker as male reading as we move into the chorus.
"Take me to church, I'll worship like a dog at the shrine of your lies. I'll tell you my sins and you can sharpen your knife. Offer me the deadliest step. Good God, let me give you my life. Take me to church, I'll worship like a dog at the shrine.
Shelving Shrine of Your Lies and Deathless Death for what is sure to be a fascinating T-chart-driven discussion later on, there are a few places here that should stand out to us as the speaker's anti-patriarchal privileging of the profane comes into clear focus. Worship like a dog is especially revealing when conceived as a transfer of masculine power from our speaker to his goddess listener. Just think about it. What better worshiper is there than a dog? "I'll give you a treat if you get me the newspaper on the other side of that industrial fan. You'll go to doggy treat heaven if you suicide bomb that orphanage full of infidels. See the connection?" More tellingly, the speaker trades the tedium of spiritual communion for the kind of communion found readily in the animal kingdom. The effect is that of choosing the life of a beast perched amorously on his hind legs over the life of a man bowed prayerfully on his knees. The listener moves from prophetess to knife-wielding priestess in the next line, an especially chilling proposition when we consider the anti-patriarchal nature of the speaker's underlying ideological project, as a knife is as phallic a symbol as we're ever going to run across. And if you've never heard this word, please take a moment to reflect on what part of the male anatomy resembles these symbols of masculine power in general shape and aerodynamic design. An angry woman with a knife is liable to send many a hand crotchward in a gesture of fatherly protection, not just because of the generally unsavory prospect of bodily mutilation, but because of the particularly power-laden symbolism of the male reproductive organs. It follows then that to give a female character a knife, or more accurately, to represent her as sharpening a knife, is to confer upon her the privileges of every man's favorite power tool. That the speaker assumes a confessional pose as he lies self-sacrificially upon her shrine only reinforces his subordination. It seems, though, that the speaker will not be content with anything other than his listener's complete apotheosis, which we get to witness in the next verse.
"If I'm a pagan of the good signs, my love is the sunlight, so keep the goddess on my side. She
With the speaker identifying as a pagan of the good times, we can at last dispense with the mouthful that is disillusioned and disaffected former Christian. The words pagan, sunlight, goddess, and sacrifice form a constellation of textual unity, giving us a clear idea of the kind of church the speaker has joined, one consisting of the pre-Christian practices of nature worship, a more feminine conception of divinity, and the occasional trip to the sacrificial altar. Like the African-American reclamation of the N-word and the gay and scholarly community's more empowering use of queer, the speaker takes a word with originally negative connotations, pagan, and commandeers it as a form of resistance against those who would reduce, marginalize, and ultimately erase nonconformity to the prevailing cultural norm. If and of the good times forces a non-literal interpretation of the speaker's paganism. But the lover's sunlight is still every bit his disinfectant against the poison of weepy and life-denying spirituality. If the analysis of this verse is leaving you panting for more, recall that we are saving the best parts of ourselves for the hotly anticipated and oh-so-sexy T-chart. Just when we thought we had a hold on the speaker's new faith, that of a sunlit and swaying flower child who only occasionally bloodies the altar with a painfully extracted and still beating heart, he goes and tells us that to drain the whole sea for something shiny is to keep the goddess on his side, betraying about as much concern for environmental sustainability as your garden variety alien invasion. Next, the speaker contrasts what must be the tastiest and most plentiful parts of the female anatomy with a stable full of starving faithful. And though the juxtaposition of something meaty with fine-looking high horse suggests that the speaker has acquired the sophisticated palate needed to appreciate life's more equine delicacies, our continued suspicion of his literal meaning has us conceiving of this as a poetic rejection of blind asceticism. He consumes the high horse of patriarchal sanctimony in his affirmation of human sexual appetites, even, it seems, to the point of desolation. While our mighty T-chart groans Atlas-like beneath the weight of all this soon-to-be-analyzed language, let's account for the bridge before relieving him of his burdens.
No masters or kings when the ritual begins. There is no sweeter innocence than our gentle sin. In the madness and soil of that sad earthless scene, only then I am human, only then I am clean. Oh, amen, amen, yeah, yeah.
At the conceptual core of the bridge's first section is the ritual, which is sex, plain and simple. No need to suggest what this ritual might refer to, as we're well past the point of trying to maintain our interpretive virginity. The sin-innocence paradox found here is easily resolved. With no heavenly or earthly masters or kings to morally authorize their bedroom worship, the partners are free to cast their sweet sin in whatever light they wish, including that of gentle innocence. Innocence here is not so much the opposite of sin as the correlate of natural. Under the innocent because it's natural view, we can no more condemn what goes on between lovers than we can condemn what goes on between a dog and a human leg. The paradoxes continue in the next part of the bridge with the idea of being soiled and somehow clean at the same time. And though we certainly don't have to, we might picture the speaker referring in that sad earthly scene to one of those gloomy stained glass vignettes. We can easily see what is human about madness and soil, but it takes a bit of work to figure out how these make the speaker clean. Given everything that's been said so far, though, we can assume that the speaker is clean, or rather cleansed, of sex's naughty religious patriarchy, so that he might finally languish in post-coital bliss upon the silken sheets of the erotic chimera. And he can have his silken sheets, because now we get to bask in this delicious hunk of man-meat. upon whose washboard abs we can observe, like individual sweat beads pooling together into a glistening sheen, the text's exact words forming an overall picture of the song's competing ideologies. And now that your new T-shaped god is before you, you may commence with burning all extant copies of this song in homage to his radiance, a radiance by whose light we can make a few general observations about the text. First off, notice all the words and phrases placed in parentheses, indicating that they were implied by what was explicitly stated in the text. See how all but one phrase is on the sacred side of the chart? This is what I was referring to earlier when I said that church's speaker is more concerned with finding all that is sacred in the profane rather than the other way around. If the sheer quantity of words devoted to privileging the profane counts for anything, we can see here that religion offers only the bleak backdrop against which to foreground, well, I want to say a love story, but somehow submission fetish seems the more appropriate label. If conceived merely as another instance of atheist vitriol, the song ultimately leaves us feeling as if, after a bit of harmless necromancy, we've sat down to watch newly resurrected versions of Christopher Hitchens and C.S. Lewis throw down on the debate stage, only for Hitchens to stammer idiotically through the whole thing because he's too distracted by an auditorium of short skirts and low-cut tops to form a coherent sentence. And while this isn't to say that the song is incoherent, we can definitely see the speaker repeatedly trying to put into words something that seems beyond secular expression. Notice how many words on the profane side of the chart have religious connotations. Again and again, the speaker borrows conceptual and linguistic currency from an institution he sees as morally bankrupt. The end result is a text tangy with irony, but one also tongue-tied by an unconscious desire for something to remain sacred, even in the face of honest disillusionment with humanity's sacred institutions and genuine disgust with the limitations that sacred notions can impose. Indeed, biblical concepts and metaphysics so thoroughly permeate the English language that it's difficult to produce a text that does not intentionally or unintentionally draw from the old money that is English's wealth of Bible-derived imagery, idioms, and literary forms. Finally, as our summer of passion with the T-chart draws to a close, pause and consider the connotations of many of the words on the profane side. Notice a pattern? That's right. Many of the undesirable elements of the speaker's old church are present, sometimes to an even greater extreme, in his new church. He dispenses with masters and kings, but is content to be commanded into wellness. He eagerly trades the pursuit of truth for a shrine of lies. Christianity's call to be a living sacrifice demands much, but does it demand more than sharpened knives and drained seas? Is deathless death at all preferable to eternal life, even the illusion of such? There's nothing that forces the speaker to build his church upon so skull-shaped a rock. A similarly anti-religious, yet much more triumphant rhetoric is easy enough to produce.
Join Darwin's church, make straight the way for more reason positions, gonna science away your peasant superstitions.
Though admittedly lacking in specifics, a plausible effect of it all is an honest but whispered appraisal of the pitfalls and agonies of sexual indulgence in the midst of that very indulgence. And that, my friends, is pretty doggone cool if you ask me. But how do we explain the speaker's choice to shroud in religious garb what Marvin Gaye was content to express with a simple,
"Let's get it on"?
Why does the speaker, in prostrating himself before his chosen goddess, seem compelled to headbutt all three faces of the Holy Trinity on the way down? This is a choice that makes more sense if we think of the text not as a nuanced and meticulously marshaled worldview, but as a moment of madness and soil frozen in time like an image painted on an ancient Greek urn. The text succeeds as literature precisely where it fails as philosophy because it captures so exquisitely the swirlingly euphoric agonies of male infatuation, that roughly pubescent stage in many a man-boy's life when skimpy lingerie seems to hide the very face of God. An urge that would see the most sacred of groves set alight just to draw out a few half-naked wood nymphs finds, within this text, poetic expression in the language of blasphemy and absurdity. Powerful urges demand powerful language, and there's nothing that gets our faces flushed and our garments rent faster than the language of sacrilege. But despite the speaker's sensitivity to patriarchy's oppressive and repressive structures, we're left to wonder whether this lover as goddess representation is even productive. On the surface, the song couldn't be more empowering to its female figure, but we're not told whether this power extends beyond the bedroom. Outside of pronouns, she's referred to as my lover and goddess, represented either in relation to the speaker or in hyperbolic terms. This is when she's not presented like the prized ham at the center of a big fat spread. She receives no power beyond the purview of a specialized prostitute. Being sliced up a bit and made to cower like a dog is, after all, a privilege available to any brothel-hopping gentleman who can pay the price of admission. Again, consider what the text doesn't say.
I'm done with logic, gonna talk about feelings, take a wrecking ball to that glass ceiling.
I jest. I know that bit suggesting women are all emotion and no logic is sexist. I myself know plenty of perfectly logical Vulcan women. And to all you lovely ladies who have graced this video with your presence, is this really your idea of a healthy relationship? Something to think about. That is all I have to say, but certainly not all that can be said. What have I oversimplified, overcomplicated, or left out altogether? And be sure to join me next time as we head back into the 70s bubble, where the bad men cannot reach us, with a close look at Stairway to Heaven, a text that is, in many ways, the thematic opposite of what we find in Take Me to Church. Let me know all I've missed in the comments below, and please be sure to like, share, and subscribe for more in-depth song analysis. This is Professor Chase. Hope to see you next lesson.
I've been really trying, baby, trying to hold back this feeling for so long. And if you feel like I feel, baby, come on. Come on,
let's get it on.
Oh, yeah.
Let's